Hello friends, welcome back to another important video. Friends, in this video, we will learn a very important concept relating to factoring and forfaiting. Please note, this topic is there in Principles paper of JAIIB and Bank Financial Management of CAIIB. This topic is equally important for CCP, that is Certified Credit Professional candidates also. Every year, question is asked from this topic, but many candidates commit mistakes in this topic since they have lots of confusion and doubts. So do watch this video till end. And one thing I can guarantee is that you will not commit any mistake in the question related to this topic in your examination. Now, before moving forward, if you haven't subscribed to this channel, then do it now. Since this is the only quality channel where I focus a lot on providing quality content, so that your journey to your examination becomes fairly easy. Also join my Facebook group, which is a group of like-minded and goal-oriented aspirants. There I post lots of one-pagers and other resources from time to time that are very important for your examination. Lastly, don't miss to download your free JAIIB and CAIIB resources ebook. All the links are there in description to this video, so do join after you finish this lecture. Now friends, let's see what you will learn in this lecture. I will start off with explaining the concept of factoring in layman language so that you will understand the complex term of factoring. Then I will explain the formal definition of factoring along with some other important points. Next, you will learn about various parties in factoring process. Then you will learn factoring mechanism practically. Here you will learn various steps in the process of factoring. Then we will learn about types of factoring. Friends, please note we will learn the four most important types which are commonly asked in the examination. Then friends, we will move on with the other half of this lecture and learn about forfaiting in layman language. So this explanation will make the concept of forfaiting crystal clear. After this, you will learn the formal definition of forfaiting and other important points. Lastly friends, I have not included the case study in this video since this will make the video pretty lengthy. So case study on factoring and forfeiting is included in next part of this video. So this is ideally a two-part series. This video is a theory video and next video will be a practical case study video. So let's go straight to the lecture and understand the concept of factoring in layman language. Friends, in normal day-to-day business, the client, that is supplier of the goods, sells the goods to the customer on credit. He then sends invoices to the customer directly and also collects the payment directly from the customer on due date, as you can see in this process flow. Now friends, this has two problems. First, it blocks the funds of the seller. And secondly, you have to keep knocking the door of the debtors or customers. So this is definitely a tiring process. And in most occasions, customers don't even pay at the given date or there are bad debts which are similar to NPAs in banks. Now to avoid this difficulty, here comes our factor, which is basically a third party or we can say an agent or agency. So the moment client sends the goods to the customer, he also informs to the customer that the collection of the payment will be done by his factor. Thus, factor is given the powers and authority by the seller to collect the money on his behalf from the debtors. But friends, please note, no one will give any service for free. So here also this agent or factor will definitely charge on some commission or factor fees for its services for the client, that is seller. Not only this, he will also provide some percentage of advance, say 80% of the receivable to the client, that is seller. So as you can see, your both problems are getting solved. That is, your funds are also not getting blocked since factor is paying you 80% of the advance. And also your headache of knocking the doors of the customers is also gone. It is now the job of the factor to recover the amount from the customer. So friends, this whole arrangement in financial terms is defined as factoring. Hope this simplified explanation is clear to you. Now friends, before moving forward with the lecture, don't forget to get your CAIIB resources. These are Advanced Bank Management and Bank Financial Management Secret Sauce books, which will cover full CAIIB syllabus in summarized manner. These books also cover some advanced topics that are not covered in your textbooks. Now these advanced topics are usually asked in the examination, since IIBF is normally going out of syllabus from last few papers. Next, you also need to practice questions and case studies from our 1000 series. Both these question banks come with detailed explanations. All the links are there in description to this video. So don't forget to get these after you finish this lecture. So friends, let's move ahead and see the formal definition of factoring in financial terms. So please note, factoring is an arrangement with which a financial intermediary called factor collects the accounts receivable on behalf of the seller of the goods or services. Here also note two important points. First, the factor may also advance money to the firm at an agreed interest rate and earn interest on the amount advanced. Now, this is the general market practice. So, amount advanced by the factor to the client is given at an interest rate which is decided based on the current MCLR. Also note, the factor will maintain a margin or reserve while advancing the money to the firm. Now friends, this is very important. As you have seen in my previous explanation, that only partial amount is advanced for the account receivable. Generally, it's 75 to 80% of the receivables. Please note these two important points since this will play a crucial role when we will solve the case studies on factoring. Let's now look at the parties in factoring contract in detail. As you have seen earlier, there are three parties involved generally in a factoring contract. First one is buyer of the goods, that is customer, who has purchased the goods or services on credit and as such has to pay the same once the credit period gets over. Then second party is seller of the goods, that is client, who has supplied goods or provided services to the customers on credit terms. And finally we have our factor, which is a third party or agent, who purchases the invoices, that is receivables, from the seller of the goods and collects the money from the customers of his clients. So friends, hope the parties in factoring process is clear to you and see the detailed mechanism or factoring process in a step-by-step manner. So friends, as you have seen, the first step in factoring process is that the customer places an order with the client for the goods or services on credit. After this, the client delivers the goods to the customer. However, all the invoices must bear the notification that the invoices have been assigned in favor of the factor and accordingly payment must be made to the factor. In the third step, the client sends the invoices to the factor. Now the factor then provides the advance, that is prepayment, to the client, say 75 to 80% of the invoice value on production of a copy of invoice. The remaining balance, that is 20 to 25% of the invoice value, will be paid to the client after the factor has been paid by the customer on maturity date, depending on the type of the factoring arrangement. In next step, the factor sends monthly statement of accounts to the customer and follow-up is done if it still remains unpaid by the due date. The customer then pays money to the factor on due date. Finally, the factor makes the balance payment of the invoice value, that is left out 25 to 30% which he blocked at the time of giving advance, back to the client. So friends, hope the factoring mechanism is clear to you. Feel free to ask any question in case you face any difficulty. Now friends, before moving forward with the lecture, if you are targeting JAIIB, then it's must for you to get our JAIIB resources. We offer a bunch of 5 books. These three are 1000 series question banks, which provides you comprehensive practice of your examination. Then we have secret sauce book, which is summarized theory of full JAIIB syllabus in one book. After this, you don't need to read your bulky textbooks. Lastly, we offer one full book on case studies. This comes with 400 case studies with detailed explanations. All the links are there in description to this video. So don't forget to get JAIIB resources well before examination. Now friends, let's move forward with our lecture. Now friends, let's see cost of factoring, which is basically the cost incurred to the client for getting the services of a factor. So there are two types of cost in factoring services. First is service fee or factor fee. Now this is levied for the work involved in administering the sales ledger as well as protection against the bad debts. This factor fees is calculated as a bill discounting percentage of gross value of invoices factored and is assessed on the basis of, first is gross annual sales volume, then second is number of customers, then third is number of invoices and credit notes, and finally degree of risk represented by the customer. Then friends, the next cost of factoring services is discount charge, that is interest charge. Now this is basically levied on the advance provided by the factor and is computed on the basis of MCLR of banks plus premiums for credit risk. Now it is calculated on a day-to-day basis on the advances outstanding and it ranges from 1 to 3% above the MCLR rate. Let's finally see the types of factoring. Please note there are many types of factoring services, but I will discuss the three most important types which are generally asked in the examination. The first one is recourse factoring. Now, under a recourse factoring, the bad debts losses are borne by the firm that is seller itself. So, under this arrangement, the factor purchases the receivables on the condition that any loss arising out of bad debts will be borne only by the seller of the goods or services. For example, suppose a factor has advanced an amount of Rs. 3.6 lakhs against a receivable of Rs. 4 lakh. Now, later, this amount turns out to be bad. Then under a recourse factoring arrangement, the factor can recover the sum of Rs. 3.6 lakhs from the client, that is seller itself. In other words, under a recourse factoring arrangement, the factor has a recourse to the client if the debt purchase turns out to be irrevocable. The next is non-recourse factoring. Any loss arising from bad debts will be borne by the factor. So under this arrangement, the client gets full protection. So under this arrangement, the client gets full credit protection. Please note, most sellers prefer this mode of factoring as this reduces their worries for bad debts. Finally, we have maturity factoring. Now under this type of factoring arrangement, the factor does not make any advance payment. The factor pays the client either on a guaranteed payment date or on the date of collection. The guaranteed payment date is usually fixed, taking into account the previous ledger experience of the client and a period for slow collection after the due date of invoice. Friends, hope all these types are clear to you. Now let's move on to the other part of this lecture, that is forfeiting. So friends, let's understand this in layman language so that the concept is clear to you. Friends, please note, factoring was the concept used when both buyer and seller were in same region or country. But what if the buyer and seller are in different countries? Now here the recovery process becomes pretty complex. So in case of international trade, instead of factor, we use the term forfeiter. So in case of forfeiting, the exporter will send the goods to the importer on credit. Importer also informs the exporter that all the payments will be made via their bank, which we are terming importer's bank. Now the exporter also appoints a third party agency called forfeiter to collect the dues from the importer's bank. The forfeiter then makes the advance payment to the exporter, as was the case in factoring. Forfeiter finally collects the payment from the importer's bank and settles his dues. So friends, hope this layman explanation is clear to you. I will explain you the step-by-step process in detail in few minutes. So first we will see the formal definition of forfeiting. Now forfeiting refers to the financing of receivables pertaining to international trade. This we have already seen earlier that forfeiting is only used when both buyer and seller are in different countries. We can also define forfeiting as a mechanism by which the right of export receivables of an exporter, that is client, is purchased by a financial intermediary, that is forfeiter, without recourse to him. Friends, please note this point as it has been asked in the exams earlier. That is, forfeiting is always on a non-recourse basis. Next, let's understand the mechanism of forfeiting in a step-by-step manner. In the first step, there is commercial contract between exporter and importer. Once this is done, there is delivery of goods by exporter to the importer on credit. After this, the importer makes contract with his bank to give guarantees which will be given in respect of payment against negotiable instruments on the due date. Now once this is done, the importer delivers the negotiable instruments, either bill of exchange or promissory note, to the exporter. Simultaneously, the exporter also makes contract with the forfeiter, and negotiable instruments received from the importer are endorsed without recourse in favor of the forfeiter. The forfeiter, after making the due diligence, makes the advance payment of discounted negotiable instrument to the exporter, which is generally face value of the bill less discounted amount. Then friends, these negotiable instruments are then presented to the importer's bank. Finally, importer's bank makes the payment on presentation of negotiable instruments on maturity. So friends, hope this full step-by-step mechanism of forfeiture is clear to you. So with this, I have wind up this video. Hope both factoring and forfaiting is clear to you. In next video, I will solve a very important detailed case study on this concept. So don't miss the next video of this series. The case study which we are going to discuss is very important with respect to your examination. Also, don't forget to get your JAIIB and CAIIB resources. All these are very important for your examinations. All the links to JAIIB and CAIIB resources are there in description to this video, so don't miss out on these. So thank you and all the best for your examination.